Population is an important national issue, and it should be discussed and debated. And our committee went into this with the political interest in family planning, and we found it is almost zero. 0.15% parliament questions ever were on population and family planning. On what are the factors which are responsible for high birth rate? Mm-hmm. And what did I find? Education is number one, particularly of girls. Mm-hmm. As the education level goes up, the number of children goes down. Across the board, without exception. Yes, Muslims have the highest birth rate. So what? Who has the second highest birth rate? The Hindus. So there's no big deal. Right, to give the impression that Muslims are just producing like rabbits is wrong. So this is one political dimension. The fact that the sterilization was forced on the people, and there was a backlash, and as you know, Indira Gandhi lost the next election very badly. We have not recovered from that backlash. So in the sense that till today, politicians are shying away from taking up population as a subject. It is now, you won't find it mentioned in the manifesto.
Hello and welcome to this very special series of interview. Today we have with us a very interesting guest on the show, Dr. S.Y. Qureshi. He is a former Chief Election Commissioner of India, and he has come up with his new book, Population Myth, Slum, Family Planning and Politics in India. Thank you so much, sir, for doing this interview with us. So we'll be talking to him on the book and what are the myths about population growth in this country. So my first question is, why did you feel the need to write such a book on population growth in this country? What struck you? What prompted you to write a book on this subject?
The book started almost accidentally. Mm-hmm. In 1995, I was Joint Secretary, Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports, when UNFPA country director at that time, he was a Canadian, Mr. Tavi Abrams, came to me and asked me to write a strategy paper for family planning among the Muslims. So I was quite surprised because this was not my subject and I was not an Islamic scholar. I'm not even now. And I had never worked in Ministry of Health and Family Welfare till then. Later on, I did. So I was taken aback and I tried to wriggle out of it, but he insisted that I can do it and I should do it. So, but then I said, all right, I'll do it on one condition, which is I'll do it for free. I'll not charge. He was offering me a lucrative 1.5 lakh rupees for a month assignment. My salary those days was 5,000 rupees a month. So it was a very attractive offer, but somehow an inner voice said that I should not take any money. And then he didn't agree and he kept on arguing. And finally, we agreed that, okay, I'll accept some money, 1 rupee. Now, 1 rupee or 1 million rupees is a financial transaction. So it attracts all the government rules. I said, you write to me. I will take Government of India's permission to do this study. And then you pay me when my remuneration, my honorarium. Mm-hmm. So I've not collected that. So now that inner voice actually turned out to be quite prophetic. Because 5 years later, I was in London in my daughter's hostel, staying with her, when I got a call from somebody who introduced himself as one Dr. Qureshi, Muslim doctors, president of Muslim Doctors Association of UK. And he said, we have read your paper and we have certain issues to discuss with you. I was very uncomfortable with the tone. And, I thought they're going to beat me up here. So I tried to wriggle out saying that, I have a flight the next morning. So the guys came to the airport. There were two of them. Mm-hmm. And they had some books in their hand. And they made a statement, the very first line of which still rings in my head after so many years. They said that Mr. Qureshi, family planning is a Western conspiracy against Islam. And they hire mercenaries like you to through UN agencies to write such a paper. Now, the fact that I was hired by a UN agency, and since I was hired, I become a mercenary. and basically to serve some political end of some Western powers. So that allegation, I was able to refute. I was able to pounce on them. Look, I have not collected any money. I have not taken any money. And if you doubt my intention, that's not fair. And I agree that the Western world is Islamophobic. They are absolutely hostile to Muslims and Islam. And at the same time, I'm not towing their line. And secondly, in this context, I do not believe that it could be their conspiracy. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, they themselves will be producing 8 to 10 children and will ask us to keep our families small, which is not the case even in UK or US, everywhere. The population growth rate is very, very low. So they, of course, were taken aback by all my arguments, and they asked me to read the literature which they gave me, which I promised I would. And I said, send me some more. I'll read that also. And let us discuss. But let us be honest in our discussion. Yeah. So that is how it began. Now, once the paper came out and I made some lectures on that, they were also very well received. By then, I had decided that this will be my national contribution because it tried to create, to remove the misunderstandings between various communities and also try to promote family planning among the Muslims, which was the objective of UNFPA country director's request to me. To write an approach paper, how to make Muslims adopt family planning. So I gave many lectures, and I didn't charge a rupee even for them. Normally, some honorarium is given for these lectures. So, and even this book's royalty, I've decided to donate to charity, because this is a subject which I have taken up to bring people together, to create the right understanding about a very crucial subject. This seeks to promote family planning among Muslims, and this seeks to tell the right-wing Hindus that their understanding that Muslims are going to overtake them is
based on... So, like, what are the biggest myths about Muslim population and population in general in this country that you have tried to bust in the book?
Yeah, you know, this is a very honest assessment of the entire thing. Now, what are the allegations of the right-wing? I start with that. One is that Muslims produce too many children, and it is disturbing the demographic balance. Mm-hmm. Thirdly, it is an organized conspiracy to overtake the Hindu. Fourthly, they say that the Muslims use polygamy for increasing the population. And hum paanch hamare pachees and hum char hamare chalees is the slogan we have heard many times from senior leaders. And then there is a myth among the Muslims that Islam prohibits family planning. So there are myths on both sides. Now, my book starts with an admission of the first two. Yes, Muslims have the highest birth rate. So what? Who has the second highest birth rate? The Hindus. So no big deal. It is the second admission which I start with, that it is true, demographic balance has been skewed a little. From 84% Hindus in 1951, by 2011, they came down to 79.9. That is 4.2 reduction. Correspondingly, Muslims from 9.8 went up to 14.1. Now, in this scenario, so these two admitted. But the third, my argument, that the way Muslims are accepting family planning at a much faster rate than the Hindus are, which is why the gap between the Hindus and Muslims is narrowing pretty fast, and very soon the two will converge. So then now, of course, polygamy and others and Muslims, as we go along, maybe I'll explain those concepts also too. But the gap is narrowing. And Muslims have taken to family planning in a big way.
So before we talk about all those topics that you mentioned in detail, I have a question with you. How has demography and population, which is a very controversial issue since the times of emergency, the process of sterilization and all that, how has this been politicized in this country?
Important point. There are two things here. One, the politicization in the sense that the right-wing Hindu have been accusing Muslims of multiplying so far, giving the impression that if a Muslim Hindu family has one child, Muslims have 10, which is not the case. At no point in time, the gap between Muslims and Hindus was one child. No point, one child, right? To give the impression that, you know, Muslims are just producing like rabbits is wrong. So this is one political dimension. Second political dimension, you rightly referred to the emergency. The fact that the sterilization was forced on the people, and there was a backlash, and as you know, Indira Gandhi lost the next election very badly. We have not recovered from that backlash. So in the sense that till today, politicians are shying away from taking up population as a subject. You won't find it mentioned in the manifesto. I have analyzed that I was a chairman of a committee constituted by National Institute of Health and Family Welfare just 2-3 years ago. And our committee went into this with the political interest in family planning. And we found it is almost zero. 0.15% parliament questions ever were on population and family planning. So I think which is bad, because family population is an important national issue and it should be discussed and debated.
Mm-hmm. So you spoke about polygamy, and there are several allegations that polygamy is prevalent so much in the Muslim population and the Muslim community. They say you produce like too many children, there's a conspiracy theory and all that. And there's like, what are the factors and the reasons for this population growth and explosion in the community or in general, according to you?
What do you think? Number one, no, as I said, there is no population explosion.
Mm-hmm.
It is that the Muslim birth rate is the highest, followed by the Hindus. Hindus' birth rate is the second highest, mind you. It is not that they are on the opposite ends of the spectrum. And the reason why they are following each other, because the socioeconomic factors which influence family planning behavior are more or less similar. But I'll come to that in detail. Now, in this case, what was the question?
So it was about polygamy. It was about the polygamy.
Like, polygamy, yeah. Now, polygamy is a factor of population explosion. Now, polygamy, there are lots of myths about polygamy.
Mm-hmm.
Number one, polygamy cannot be the reason for population explosion, because large-scale polygamy or polygamy of even a smaller scale is actually not possible, because the numbers do not exist. You must have heard of gender ratio. Gender ratio is adverse against women. A sad story in itself, because of discrimination against the girl child, we don't allow them to be even born. As a result, throughout last 100 years, the adverse gender ratio has been adverse against women. For 1,000 men in India, we had in 2011 census 940 women. In fact, last year's figure was 924 women. Now, where will I get, if I want to marry a second woman, where will I get her? Because she does not exist. In fact, statistically, I have said that statistically, no one in India has even a full wife. The number of wives is 0.9. So, secondly, what has been the fact? There has been only one report ever in the last 70 years by the government of India, the status of women committee in 1975, which they published a document called Towards Equality. And they found that all communities have some incidence of polygamy, and tribals 15%, the Buddhists and the Jains and Hindus 5.8 and Muslims 5.7. Mm-hmm. The least polygamous were the Muslims. Then I tried to see whether this...
Like, sorry to interrupt you. Where is the polygamy found the most? Like in which community?
Yeah, in the tribal belt, mm-hmm. tribal belt, because tribals have about 15% incident of polygamy. Right. Now, I try to study whether this is the finding of this study is a freak finding and only one off, or is this is backed up by some more data. So I looked at the censuses of 1931, 41, 51, and 61. And I think this aspect was not studied by the census. And we found that there was exactly the same trend, that all communities had polygamy, and the least of all was with the Muslim. And of course, in all communities, it was declining. But the fact that it existed across the board, and Muslims are the least polygamous, so that is an interesting phenomenon. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't practice polygamy, but I'm willing to fight for it, die for it, for my right. You know, this should not be taken away. I'm opposing it. I say, okay, well, let us ban it. In any case, it doesn't exist. So if we ban it, after all, 20 or 22 Muslim countries have banned polygamy. Mm-hmm. So why can't Muslims of India accept this? That's my theory. Then, thirdly, even if there is polygamy to the extent like 5.7, which I mentioned, mm-hmm. it is very good from the population growth point of view. Why? Because there are studies I've mentioned in the book that average, the only wife of a husband, if she produces 5 children, his second wife, the number of children she will produce is only 1.7. The number. Now imagine if these two women had gone to two different men, they will both be producing 5 and 5, 10 children. In this case, one is 5, the other is 1.7, so about 6 or 6.5. 6.5. So for birth rate it is fine, because that means the number of women available is small. If one man marries a second woman, correspondingly another guy will stay a bachelor. Right.
So, sir, on the front of family planning, many are saying, and you have also spoken on this, they say that in Muslim population or the Muslim community, they don't believe in family planning. How do you see this whole debate and the scenario?
Yeah. In fact, I studied this and I found this phenomenon mm-hmm. that Muslims do believe. And in fact, frankly, when I started my study in 1995, even I believed that Islam is against family planning. Mm-hmm. But when I studied the subject in depth, it was revealing for me that Islam was not only not against family planning, Islam actually was supportive of the concept. And in that context, a pioneer of the concept. And I'll tell you what. Mm-hmm. Nowhere in the, you know, as you know, we Muslims believe in the Shariat. And what is Shariat? Sharia? Quran, what Quran says. And whatever, like we have the constitution. And the constitutional provisions are spelled out by statute, by the act. Similarly, the Quran is like the constitution. Then the hadith. Hadith means what Prophet said or what he did as reported by others. So that is the second tier of Sharia. After that, there are 2-3 others, you know, consensus or interpretation and all that. So nowhere in the Quran, family planning has been prohibited. And there is an ayat of the Quran that God is telling us that whatever we wanted you not to do, we have prohibited for you. And it has been clarified that what he has not prohibited, it is not that he has forgotten to prohibit it. That means it is fine. That's the implication. So there is no prohibition. Nowhere in the Quran it has been prohibited. There are only interpretations. Some are for, some are against. So I have given all those interpretations for and against family planning. And I have come to my own interpretation, which says that Islam is the pioneer of the concept. And how do I say that? And how do I say that Islam is supportive? One verse of the Quran, to my mind, is a clinching verse. It goes like this. Oh, young men, you should marry when you have the wherewithal, because it will keep you away from promiscuity. Now, when you have the wherewithal, this is the important clause. When you have the wherewithal. Now, one poor man went to the Prophet, because as I said, that to seek explanation of Quran, they used to go to the Prophet and seek an answer and explain. A poor man went to Prophet, peace be upon him, and asked and said that Allah said that I should marry only when I have the wherewithal. I'm a poor guy, but I have my sexual needs. What should I do? So Prophet repeated that ayat and supplemented it and said that till you have the wherewithal, you should resort to fasting, because fasting suppresses such sexual desires. So it becomes a complete recipe. And there is another third hadith, second hadith, and the third in my line of argument. Then some one man went to the prophet and he said that I have many children already and I don't want any more. And I want to practice Al-Azl, which is the withdrawal method. That was the only method of family planning known those days. Yeah. So, and he said, but I want to do it. But a Jew was saying that this is a minor infanticide. So prophet said, no, what Jew said, it's a lie. It's a lie. Twice he repeated, it's a lie, which means withdrawal method. Even the method is approved. And now we have dozens of methods. But the fact that Islamic injection, when you have the wherewithal, you should marry. And then until then, you should resort to fasting to suppress your sexual desire. And this is how. So that is why I say that Islam has been misinterpreted. One thing is clear, that every interpretation of Islam has prohibited sterilization, which is fine. Fine in the sense, even the government of India doesn't expect sterilization as the top priority. In fact, it's a very low priority. They would, government of India rather discourages it. They would rather that we all follow temporary methods, spacing methods, like use of condom and whatever, copper tea and temporary methods. So therefore, but interestingly, despite the fact that all ulama and all interpretations say that sterilization is prohibited, more than 20% of Muslim women have undergone sterilization, which shows their level of interest.
So there is an allegation that population growth in the Muslim community is happening rapidly, and data also says, even if it is not rapidly, it is growing, not just in the Muslim community, but as a general topic also, the population growth and explosion is a matter of concern for this country. What do you think are the reasons for this growth and why it is not yet controlled?
Good question. In fact, I have examined this in my book. There is an entire chapter on what are the factors which are responsible for high birth rate. Mm-hmm. And what did I find? Education is number one, particularly of girls. Mm-hmm. As the education level goes up, the number of children goes down across the board, without exception. So illiterate have more children, then class 5 have lesser, class 10 have even lesser, and if you have reached graduation, even lesser. Secondly, poverty. An income. As the income goes up, number of children goes down. Thirdly, the service delivery. You know, the availability of hospitals, the doctors, nurses, where the children could be born. So, as the services go up. So, these are the factors. And religion is a factor. Among the Muslims, we did find people saying generally, it is against Islam. And I have argued, I'll come to that, what is the strategy to counter that? Mm-hmm. So these are the factors. Then my chapter, another chapter is, where do Muslims stand in all those indicators? Literacy, we are the least, most uneducated. Poverty, we are the most poor. The service delivery, poorest, because no doctor, nurse wants to go to a Muslim cluster, calling them mini Pakistan. So with such a situation, when you are not creating the enabling environment and supporting the factors which lead to family planning acceptance. So how will family planning happen? In fact, in a way, it is a miracle that despite, I know, for instance, Mewar district, where I used to be a deputy commissioner 40 years ago, mm-hmm. if there are 50 posts of doctors, 45 are vacant for 20 years, 30 years, because it's a backward area. Nobody wants to go to a backward area. Now, whether it is in Bastar area or in Mewat or anywhere, now if good officers don't go to such areas, how will they develop? And they don't go, ke saab wahan to koi school nahi hai, hospital nahi hai, hum kaise karenge, are bhai tum nahi jaoge to school kaise banega, hospital kaise aayenge? So we have to address the backwardness, these indicators.
So particularly on the topic of family planning, where do you think we are lacking? Where do we need to focus our attention and work in terms of family planning?
You know, although, quite right, although I personally feel that family planning, all India's family planning program was the first in the world in 1952. I feel that the population explosion that was the talk of the town 30 years ago converted into a positive debate of the demographic dividend. actually our manpower can be our human resource. And when we started looking at our resource, and if we develop it properly, imagine, because of the quality of human resource in India, we have we are dominating the world. 30%, 40%, 50% of all manpower in USA and in many countries are Indians. And they are only those who got qualified. If we can give that kind of quality education to more people, but all Indians, we will dominate the world. So, the demographic dividend is now everybody's concern. And another thing we used to look down upon 40 years ago was brain drain. Mm-hmm. Our intelligent people are going abroad now. Same brain drain has been a savior of India. Our economy has changed. We have $600 billion foreign exchange reserves, most of them coming from the remittances of our Indians who are working abroad, right? So therefore, our numbers became our asset rather than a liability, and it has changed our economy. And if more people can be trained and equipped with skills, then we'll go further.
So I have a last question, which is actually an amalgamation of so many various topics. So will it be right to say that particular communities or community are responsible for population growth or explosion in the country? Or is it just being done, for political gains or political parties? So they're trying to exploit the whole matter to, for political gains and political purposes. And how can India effectively implement any plan or policy to control population growth and explosion in the interest of nation? I mean, in the national interest. What do you think on that?
Obviously, this propaganda, I would say this is propaganda. Hum paanch hamare 25, hum char hamare 40. Tell me, Shubham, have you seen any Muslim, one Muslim, show me one Muslim who has four wives and 25 children? Not to talk of four wives and 40 children. Show me one. Now, obviously, this is not the truth. So somebody is lying, and that lie has to be exposed. So this is great. And I said the difference between Muslim, I had already started with the admission that Muslim rate of growth is the highest, but higher by just one child, not higher by 10 children. So let us talk on facts and numbers and not hate and divisive narrative, basically to create hatred between communities. I think that's very unfair. Now, obviously, at the same time, as I've been saying, that population is a very important national agenda, and we have been shying away from it, which is wrong. And although I would like to say that it's, India's family planning is a success story, in the sense that 24 of 29 states have already come below the replacement ratio. Replacement ratio is 2.1% growth. Now, which means that when the parents die, the two children will take over. That is a replacement. Now, 24 states have gone below the referendum. I think it's a great success. Now, there are only Bimaru states, the midterm, Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, UP, and Rajasthan, where the family planning is poor even among the Hindus. In fact, I was mentioned in my study that if Hindu family in Bihar has five children, Muslim families in Tamil Nadu, Andhra have only two children. Now, if religion was the factor, that Muslims everywhere will have 10 children. But that is not the case. And why is that the Hindus of Bihar have four, five children? Because they are also very poor. They are also illiterate. Their socioeconomic conditions are poor, so we need to address that. And if we will keep looking at it as Hindu-Muslim issue, we will be barking up a wrong tree. Actually, I have proved through my book, tried to prove through my book, that actually Hindus and Muslims are on the same end of the spectrum. Mm-hmm. Now, if Muslims have the highest birth rate, the Hindus have the second highest birth rate. Lesser than the Sikhs and the Christians, does it mean they are less patriotic than the Christians and the Hindus? If this was to be termed as an index of patriotism. So now these are all the myths which have been created and where they're very counterproductive. So we have to deal with facts and figures dispassionately, non-politically, not emotionally. but based on fact. So that's the situation.
And like, what are the ways in which the government can work on these things in national interest? I mean, on population, not just whether Muslim community is increasing or Hindus or anyone. Just like generally, how can the government work on these fronts?
Correct. You know, the government, I have mentioned, if at all it is somebody's failure, not of the communities, but an administrative failure only, although I have complimented the administration for a good policy. Why? Because, you know, all plan and policy documents from the beginning have talked or have mentioned that Muslims have the highest birth rate. It has been flagged as a concern, but no document has offered a solution. Now, when you're talking of a problem, please talk of solution in the same breath. Now, no efforts have been made to dispel the myths. For instance, suppose you are a family planning worker and you come to me. Qureshi, you have 4 or 5 children. I have only 2, by the way, and only 1 wife. So if you come to me, if you come to me that, you know, family planning is good for you and you should adopt family planning, and I just tell you that, you know, this is against my religion, Islam. Mm-hmm. Since you know nothing about Islam and you will not be able to argue further, you will just hang your head and go away. Now, that, to my mind, is a failure because we have not equipped our health staff with the right knowledge to counter this misinformation. If a Muslim says that it is against Islam, show him my book. Now, for the future, I'm willing to volunteer a resource book out of it. Yeah, what Islam says, you know, quotations from the Quran, narratives from Hadith, all that. You show them that. You look, this is your religion. Actually, your religion was a pioneer and you have forgotten it along the way. Please follow the spirit of your religion, the quality of upbringing, the health and of mothers and children and all that. So we have not equipped our health staff. Mm-hmm. Again, our failure, administration failure. And no, there is no resource book. There is no fact book for this. The parliament questions, Vidhan Sabha questions have not been asked. And I have mentioned political timidity. Politicians have become so timid of talking of population because of the backlash of emergency. I say that this is not proper. You should debate it. You should ask about it, but with honesty, with intellectual honesty, but not with a dishonest discourse.
Sir, can you just give your conclusion or your last line, what you think on the whole matter?
You know, in conclusion, what I have said is that I've told the Muslim that whatever may be the propaganda against you, ignore it. Do not start a procreation war. If the Hindus are asking Hindus to produce more children, you start producing more. You accept family planning proactively. Mm-hmm. Keep your family small. Give them education. Give them proper upbringing. And I have given a complete strategy as an administrator, as a communication expert. I have given a complete strategy how to promote family planning among the Muslims. Just to give an example, one, that prepare a resource book. Train your staff to answer these questions and take faith leaders on board or Muslim clerics on board. Explain to them. They have done a good job in Indonesia. Indonesia imams and masjid, they have been the center of population messages. Bangladesh has done a great job. So let us send our ulama to these two countries or to Iran so that they learn or invite people from there. So creating the right atmosphere through right messages, and have given a complete strategy, communication strategy, how the India should deal with this problem, because we have to make Muslims accept that their birth rate is the highest and it should not be. They have to bring it down in their own interest and in the interest of the nation.
Thank you so much, sir, for talking to us here at The Logical Indian. Thank you so much for sparing the time.
Thank you very much.